the notion of randomness, which in science has been very highly developed, has been imported into our individual lives without too much reflection upon it. And the fact is that we, our lives are very densely plotted, and we are not behaving stochastically, randomly, without order. And the things that happen to us, the people that cross our path, are, in retrospect, by most people, and by psychedelic people in prospect, seen as somehow intended, structured, architectonically laid out. An example of this that's always impressed me was years and years ago in the Orient at Angkor, I met this couple, and he had been a very large LSD dealer in the Haight and had made sufficient money that his life's goal had been to find out if there was anything in the world that worked better than his LSD. And so we fell at my friend, I was traveling with a dear friend of mine, we fell in with these people, and they were on their way to India, as were we. And once in Bombay, my friend and I were scheduled to catch a boat to the Seychelles Islands, where I was going. I had been there the year before, and I was going back to buy real estate. Well, so we told these people about the Seychelles and how wonderful they were, and so they changed their plans, decided not to go to the ashram that they had staked out in Rishikesh, decided instead to go with us to the Seychelles Islands, which we dutifully did. And well, there were many, many weird things about this trip. But anyway, we land in the Seychelles Islands, where they had never been before, and there's a long, long pier. The British East India Steam Navigation Company liners that plied that route at that time, there was no airport there then, had such a deep draft that they couldn't actually come into shore. So you had to transfer by shore boats to this long pier. So we have all our baggage and everything and transfer to the pier, and we're walking down this pier, and it's this recessional vista with this beautiful little tropical town with corrugated roofs and bending palms lying at the end of it, and these truly spectacular granite pinnacles behind it. The highest point in the Seychelles is about 2,400 feet, and it's attained within 300 yards of the beach. So what we're talking about is just a tooth of black stone that rises up, and the Seychelles are at 43 seconds south, less than a degree south of the equator. So there's this tremendous buildup of atmospherics, daily thunderstorms, downpours, rainbows, and all this was going on as we disembarked this ship, and we're carrying, everybody's each carrying a suitcase, walking into this rainbow waterfall environment. And far, far down this pier, we see these two disheveled figures with the gauntness of morphine addiction and too long upon the road. And as we get closer and closer to these people, you see that they are noticing us. And finally, the man begins to run toward us. And he runs up to my friend, the guy I had met at Angkor, the guy of the couple that we had convinced to come with us to the Seychelles. And they say, I'll change the guy's name. They say, Neil, Neil. My God, it's you! It's really you! And the guy said, I don't know you. Who are you? And he said, you don't know me? You don't know me? Look at me! He said, don't you remember 3 years ago in Tangiers? we got stoned together the night before you were going back to the States. And he said, well, wait a minute. I was in Tangiers 3 years ago. I remember getting stoned in a hotel room with a room full of people before I went. And he said, yes, don't you remember what you told me? He said, no. What did I tell you? He said, you told us that the game was running in Kenya, and that we should change all our plans, that we should give up going to Istanbul, that we should give up going the overland route to Asia, and that we should go south into Africa. We've been with the tribes for 3 years. And he lifted up his shirt and his whole chest was scarified. And he said, you told us that Africa would transform our lives. And the guy, and my friend said, yeah. Well, did it? And he said, yes, it did. And it was, and so it was very clear that my friend's rap, which had been given almost unconsciously, which it was just, you know, the end of the third joint. He was the best traveled person in this hotel room. He laid out a bunch of advice, and not realizing that these two people, who we later found out had escaped from mental hospitals in the United States and were hiding out in Tangiers, it had fallen upon them like God's holy writ, that he was the psychopomp. He was telling them what to do, and they had stories that would stand your hair on end. They had been with the Maasai drinking blood and milk. They had moved on to the Kikuyu. That's where the scarification had taken place. She had been part of various harems. He had been lion hunting. He had been mauled by a lion. I mean, they were hard-traveled characters. And it had to do with taking this rap seriously and implementing it. So I just was an observer to this whole thing, fortunately, because it could have been me.
Because it was you, because your friend had been on his way to somewhere else and you had just sideswiped him into the Seychelles.
Too true. I had deflected his path and he had deflected their paths, and now he had to reap the karma of his advice, because the Seychelles were so small a place that immediately we were an item, and these people were welded on to our lives in the minds of the immigration officials and the police and so forth, because up to that point no one had dared even approach them, and we were spotted embracing, conversing, and going to dinner with them. So it really made us part of their world. Well, the point of that story is the power of language, to make reality, and our need to take it more seriously, because your words set cascades of events in motion. I really feel this because people say to me, do you think I should do 1 gram or 5? And I realize, you know, that we're standing in some kind of really odd node where they don't know what they're asking, but an answer is being sought and it will be acted upon.